and welcome to the worship at Park Place Christian Church. We are so glad that you are worshiping with us whenever it is that you are worshiping. We hope that if you've never subscribed to our YouTube channel, that you take just a moment to do that. We also hope that you take a moment to let us know that you're worshiping with us and who's worshiping with you. We would even love to know, if you're not worshiping in Wichita Falls, where are you worshiping with us from? We know that we are a global church, and it is always fun to hear about where people are when they're tuning in. We hope that you feel God's Spirit wherever you are this day. We will take a moment and light the candles here in the sanctuary, and we invite you to do the same, to remind you that the presence of Christ that is in this place is in all places. Our scripture reading this morning comes from Galatians chapter 5, verses 22 to 24. Let us hear God's word in these words of scripture. By contrast, the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, generosity, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. There is no law against such things. And those who belong to Christ have crucified the flesh with the passions and desires. If we live by the Spirit, let us also be guided by the Spirit. Let not us become conceited, competing against one another, envying one another. These are God's words for us this day. I have, thanks to our nursery, the kitchen in our nursery, some plastic fruit. If I had thought about it, I would have gone and picked a lot of yummy tomatoes from my garden. Any gardener will tell you, even though these are plastic, they're good representations. Any gardener will tell you that you don't automatically get an orange or a banana. You have to plant a seed. You have to nurture the seed and make sure that you don't get you have to make sure that it gets enough water, but not too much water. You have to make sure that it gets enough sunlight, but not too much sunlight that it burns it. You have to make sure that the pollination happens the right way. I learned that a zucchini has to be pollinated 7 times for the fruit to be good and produce a good vegetable. You have to make sure that the soil has enough nutrients and the right type of nutrients, but not too much of another kind. You don't automatically get a good piece of fruit. The same is true for these fruits of the Spirit. I would try to sing the song, but even the song doesn't help me remember all of the fruits. But in order to have these things, you have to nurture them. You have to nurture peace and patience and kindness and generosity and faithfulness, gentleness and self-control. They're not things that you just automatically have in your life. They're things that you have to nurture. And so this week, our friends who are young and old, I encourage you to pick one of the fruits that you want to focus on over the next 6 weeks. And as we explore different ways that we are committed to Christ, explore how you might nurture one of these fruits of the Spirit through the different disciplines that we'll be talking about the next 6 weeks as we explore our commitment to Christ. Will you pray with me? Awesome God, thank you so much for sending Jesus. Thank you for the example that he showed in these fruits. And God, may we nurture them in our own lives. Amen.
In this time of desperation, when all we know is doubt and fear, there is only one foundation. We believe in this broken generation. When all is dark, you help us see. There is only one salvation. Jesus Christ, we believe in the Holy Spirit, and He's given us new life. We believe in the crucifixion. We believe that He conquered death. We believe in the resurrection, and He's coming back again. We believe. So let our faith be more than anthems, greater than the songs we sing. And in our weakness and temptations,
Almighty God, creator of us all, grant us the patience to wait and listen to your voice. Help us to not only seek answers in the silence of prayer, but rather let your thoughts travel through us and out into the world. Oh God, how thankful we are that you came into our lives and that you continue to work through us and to speak to us through the Holy Spirit. You know, Lord, that we are not perfect, that we want to improve. Show us, O God, how we can do that. We pray today for God's children, young and old. We pray especially that children growing up in this world where things are changing, where the world is fearful, where their world is so different than they expected and their parents expected, we pray that they may find peace and love somewhere in their lives, whether it is at home or at school or through church. We pray that we can be an extension of that love, O God, and love your children. We pray for people who are seeking a cause that is worthy of their life's commitment. And we pray especially on this day as we explore our commitment to you, we pray for people who are discerning a first-time commitment or how they may recommit their lives this day. We pray especially for them. We pray for those who are ill and injured. Be with them and those who are caring for them. May they know your strength and wisdom. We pray for those who are grieving. We pray for those who are waiting medical diagnoses. And we pray for those who love them. We pray for those living in conditions that we cannot even imagine, whether those conditions come from abuse, neglect, disaster, war, or so many things. God, may they know your light in their darkness. We pray these things and we lift our voices to you, praying the prayer Jesus taught his disciples, saying, Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we have forgiven our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Seems like a lot of anger going round, hate and fear to abound. Seems like a lot of answers can't be found. Seems like a lot of that going round. Seems like a lot of your name called in vain. Seems like a lot of misery and pain. Seems like a lot of mountains that were mounds. Seems like a lot of that going round. Seems like a lot of not knowing what to do, and a lot less praying and looking God for you. Seems like we're lost and somehow can't be found. Seems like a lot of that going round. Take away the darkness, show us the light. Give us your wisdom to know and do what's right. Help us to follow you to reach that holy ground, till they say there's a lot of that going round. Help us to follow you to reach that holy ground, till they say there's a lot of that going round.
Story going around about a husband and wife who were sitting in their living room, and they were talking about their wills. And the husband said to his wife, "Now look, just so you know, I don't want to live in a vegetative state, okay? I don't want to be dependent on some machine. I don't want to be dependent on fluids from a bottle. I just don't want to live in that state, and if I do, I need you to just pull the plug." The wife thought for a moment, and she got up, unplugged the TV, and threw out his beer. Oh dear, how funny are we? We're a population who some have said we've gotten kind of lazy in our life, or maybe we've gotten too dependent on things, but our country is built on the whole concept of independence. We like having our freedoms. We like having that dependency to choose what we want to do, when we want to do it, where we want to do it. Sometimes that's a good thing. But at other times, it might actually get us into trouble. Sometimes we can make decisions that, instead of giving this kind of freedom that we're looking for, may actually give us, well, we feel like we're jailed. There's a radio commentator some of you know very well, Paul Harvey. He used to do a series called The Rest of the Story. But he talked about a group of scientists, and these scientists wanted to see if they could get a chimpanzee to teach them how to write. Now, we do know that chimpanzees can do some sign language and are pretty good at it, actually, but for 14 years, these scientists labored and labored diligently and patiently with this particular chimpanzee to get him to write. Now, he lived in a cage, didn't particularly like that cage so much, but that was the laboratory, that's where he lived. And so finally they believed that they arrived when this chimpanzee could write. They called in all the scientists to come watch this day, and they had all the newspaper and TV stations to come, and this was going to be the big reveal where this chimpanzee for the first time was going to write. And with bated breath, everybody watched as that piece of paper slid in front of the chimpanzee. Pressing in for everyone to see, the chimpanzee took the pencil in his hand, and they watched him make one letter after another. And when he was finished, he had written, "Let me out." I don't know about you. Any part of your life that you feel so imprisoned that you would like for somebody to let you out? Have that sense of freedom again where you can actually breathe? Our scripture passage today in Galatians talks about, a little earlier in this text, beginning at verse 19, some of the things we get into trouble with. Some of those things that we do that maybe we know we shouldn't do. Let's review. The acts of the sinful nature are obvious. Sexual immorality, impurity, debauchery, idolatry, witchcraft, hatred, discord, jealousy, fits of rage, selfish ambition, dissensions, factions, envy, drunkenness, orgies, and the like. I warn you, as I did before, that those who live like this will not inherit the kingdom of God. Well, I don't know anybody who's done any of that. Have you? Well, some of us would have to be honest with ourselves and say, well, yes, I have. Maybe I haven't done some of the big ones, but maybe I've done some of the littler ones. Maybe I have struggled with jealousy. Maybe I've had fits of rage here and there. Maybe there are some of those things that I've done I probably shouldn't do, isn't the best for me. But then we have to ask ourselves, why do we do that? What are the values that we're attaching to those things? Could it be that even though Jesus Christ says to us, the kingdom of God is yours? Remember that in other passages of the Bible, Jesus talks about, I've given you this. I've given you everything before the foundations of the world. I've given you these things. It's already done. And yet we find ourselves turning towards things that are the very thing that imprison us. The gazelle. If you ever get a chance to be in Africa or see on your screen the gazelle, they are a beautiful animal that can run and they can jump up to 12 feet. And yet, if you have just a small wall, if the gazelle can't see the land on the other side of that wall, it believes it cannot jump. Isn't that interesting? That for a gazelle, so much like us, we have to see the proof of the other side before we jump in. It's hard, isn't it, sometimes in our lives when we want to be assured that there's going to be safety. We want to make sure that if I jump in, if I do this, if I give up this security that I know imprisons me anyway, at least I know the outcome. You know, we Christians are given abundancy. Isn't it interesting? The fruits of the Spirit is this big bowl of fruit. And yet we trade it for burgers. Isn't it interesting that we find ourselves sometimes living in that state of scarcity because we don't quite believe the abundancy that Jesus promises us, doesn't tell us a white lie, doesn't say that to us so that maybe we'll follow. He says, this is true. I tell you the truth. Why do we do this? For many of us, we choose these things of hatred because we didn't feel the love from somebody else. We choose envy because we don't think we can have what somebody else has. We choose to maybe take our neighbor's things because we don't know or don't believe we can get those things ourselves. We know that when we begin to live in the whole description prior to this, of all the things that break us down, comes out of that sense that we're not enough. We're not good enough. How could God give that to me? Maybe God will give that to the other person, but God isn't going to give that to me. I don't deserve it. Somehow, I think I'm the enemy. So I'm going to act in a way that harms me. Debauchery. I love that word, debauchery. Debauchery. You know that I had a friend one time that had to live in this expensive house and have this expensive pool and have an even more expensive pool cover. Had to have the newest car with all the bells and whistles on it. But guess what they also had? Debt up the wazoo. I remember my preacher used to say, yes, they were buying all these things, doing all these things to catch up to the Joneses, and then the Joneses refinanced. We think that buying things will make us feel better. Well, it does. Ever since I heard somebody talk about that, I began to look at, every time I went to the store to buy something, I thought, why am I buying that and not that? Because that one makes me feel good. Why does a shopaholic buy things? Because they don't feel good to start with. So if I go to the store, I'll buy something that makes me feel good. And it does for a while. Remember that time you bought that new car and you said, oh, that car, if I get nothing else in life, that new car, I'll be happy for the rest of my life. And we think, woo, we get to drive around town, have it nice and shiny, and drive around with pride through the streets. And look at me, look at, isn't this a fancy drive? And then the payment comes. And all of a sudden, you buy something that's really out of your price range. And now you're resenting this vehicle because now you can't do some things that you wanted to do before. You can't even put the things on your table you want to put on there before because all that money is going for the vehicle. Dave Ramsey, in his Financial Peace class, Financial Peace University, talks about money a lot, obviously. But he says, when we think we can't have it, we go get it anyway. The banks made lots of money on all of us because the bank said, hey, we are in a generation that has to have it right now, when the generation before us said, we save, then we buy. Now we buy and pay it off over the next 5 to 10 years of our life. We become a slave to money. Disease, dis-ease comes when we are in that scarcity mindset. And what we forget is that we are a people of God who says, I didn't create you to live in scarcity mindset. I created you so that you could live in abundance. And I don't think we believe it. Imagine, if you will, for me, for just a moment, what would your life look like if you truly believed that you could have an abundant life? Now, sometimes people will equate that with money. Money's a piece of it, but it's certainly not all of it. At all. Think of abundancy in spirit. I remember being in Puerto Rico one time visiting, and this pastor friend of mine was taking me around to her congregants in the neighborhood, and one of them had just gotten her car stolen. In Puerto Rico, everybody gets their car stolen. Nobody has insurance because it was too expensive. So once the car's gone, it's gone. And she said, I'm not upset. Her son was upset. Even the police officer was upset. How can you be so calm? Because somehow, some way, God will take care of me. She truly believed that. What would our life look like? Having peace in our life, having love and joy, having patience. I had a friend one time that we would run around together, but if we got into the grocery store and there was a line, she'd start talking. And it was kind of embarrassing. What's the matter with those people? Why can't they come on? What's the matter? What's this line taking too long? No patience. Do you think the anxiety level is up a little bit? Maybe a little. But Jesus says, look, guys, here's the deal. I've offered this to you. I have offered to you that if you follow me, you will have an abundant life. Now, if you don't have an abundant life, what's wrong? Back in Luke, in his gospel, Jesus says, come and follow me. And do you remember that there were several who had excuses about why they couldn't follow? Well, I will, but let me go bury my parents first. Well, they're in good health. What is it that makes us so afraid to follow Jesus, the one who says that if you follow me, good things will happen to you? That's not to say no bad thing will happen, but if a bad thing happens, you're okay. You've got that peace and that assurance that Christ is with you through the difficult times. Why is that hard for us? Jesus says, act now. And what we've said is, you know, I can go with you some of the way, but I'm not so sure about all the way. If we live by the Spirit, Jesus tells us it will change our life. If we live by the Spirit, if we take our focus off of our worries and what we don't have and start putting it on what we do have. Somebody once said, if you feel depressed, if you feel unsure of yourself, get out an abundance journal. Begin to say, every day I'm gonna list five things I'm grateful for. Can you believe that people who've done gratitude journals actually feel happy in their life? It doesn't matter what's surrounding them. It matters what's in their head and their heart. They find their happiness there. What if we did do a gratitude journal and we decided, you know, from here going forward, I'm going to make some changes in my life? Have you ever tried to drive your car looking in the rearview mirror? You're not going to get very far, are you? You're going to crash. But Jesus says, look out the front window. Look where you can go now. Look at the opportunities that are before you right now. Do these things. Your life will change. But Jesus says in verse 19, these are the things that will kill you. These are the things that will kill your spirit, could even possibly kill your life. But I say, focus on verse 22 on. These are the things that will give you life. These are the things that will give you a return on your time and your focus. Fred Craddock, the great disciple preacher, was once talking about when he was visiting the home of some former students of his after they had graduated, and they had dinner together. They had a nice time. They had a big greyhound dog. The greyhound dog was on the floor playing with the children, and they were really doing well. And the student said, yeah, this is a greyhound who's a rescue from the track. He was, for 10 years, he was a racer on the track down in Florida, a professional racer. And we rescued him, and now he's our family dog, and we love him, and he's just the best thing ever. And so then as the student was taking his son to bed, Fred Craddock was left alone with the greyhound, and he said, tongue-in-cheek, well, you may not believe this, but the greyhound and I had a conversation. The greyhound looked at me and he said, so your first time in Connecticut? And Fred Craddock, not being concerned that the dog is talking to him, he says, no, I went to school here a long time ago. The greyhound said, yeah, I guess you heard that I was I'm coming up here from Miami. See, I was a racer, professional racer for 10 years. And Fred said, yeah, I heard you retired. And the Greyhound said, well, who told you that? He said, well, your master told me that you had retired. He goes, oh, no. I didn't retire. No, that's not what happened. I tell you what, I spent 10 years as a professional racer going around that track every day for 10 years. And I tell you something else, me and a bunch of the other dogs, we were chasing that rabbit. We saw it up ahead of me. We're all trying to catch up to that rabbit. And let me tell you something. He said, one day I got close to that rabbit, and I got a good look at that rabbit, and I discovered it was fake. I spent my whole life chasing a fake rabbit. No, I didn't retire. No, I quit. I wonder, when we look at our own lives, how many years we've been chasing a fake rabbit. Chasing that very thing we thought was going to give us some kind of change, something that was going to give us definition, something that was going to make us happy, joyful, with peace and kindness and patience, only to discover it's fake. But Jesus says, look, you've had some time in the world. You've had time to kind of check things out. Are you ready to give me a chance now? Are you ready to truly, in the depths of your heart and your spirit, believe what I'm telling you? Because the deal is, Jesus asks us to choose. To whom will you serve? We're lucky in this country that we have the opportunity, the freedom to choose the direction of our life, the focus of our life. And we at Park Place Christian Church will be spending the next 6 weeks looking at different aspects of our life. And we're all going to be challenged to follow Christ in some new ways. Do we want debauchery? Or do we want joy and love and peace and kindness? Ultimately, Jesus, who never presses himself upon anyone, says to us, I'm here. How about you choose me? Amen and amen. What a joy for each and every one of us that every week, no matter where we are, we have the opportunity to come together around a table. Now, back in the day, it used to be families would gather every evening around the dinner table. Today, that doesn't get to happen so much. So we're so grateful when we have an opportunity to gather around the Lord's table, that we get to do it with our family and our friends, our loved ones, no matter where we are. The elements may not all be the same, but the meaning behind it is everlasting. As Jesus met with his disciples before he was to leave them, he left them a reminder. He said, "When you see this loaf of bread, I break this in front of you to remind you that my body is broken that you may be whole. And whenever you see this and whenever you eat this, remember me." Likewise, Jesus took the common drink, something they would share over and over again, but gave it new meaning when he said, "When you drink this, remember that it is my blood shed for you so that you might live." Jesus has always been after our abundance, after our goodwill, after good things for us. He wants us to live our highest, fullest, our best. And he says to us each week, when you take this meal, it's like taking an energy drink or a vitamin. This is going to help you move through each day and give you the sustenance you need to live an abundant life. Let us share this meal as one together. Intro video is all. They do have a card, but it's just the intro video. I don't think they're. So we hope that this service today will inspire you and invite you to further deepen your commitment to Christ. Or if you've never made a commitment to Christ, this be the day you say yes. We have a card, and you'll be getting this each week on the different topics that we talk about, on making a commitment to Christ. You can get this online, or you can also call us if you didn't get one, and we'll make sure that you get one of these cards. You can go to Google Docs and download it for yourself if you'd like. So on this card, it gives you some opportunities of, am I ready to make a commitment to Christ to follow him? Your first comment may say, no, not today, I'm not ready to make a commitment, or no, but maybe someday, or no, but I want to with all my heart, or yes, today I will, and then gives you some graduations about your level of commitment for that at this time. There is no pressure at all about what you sign on this card. It's really more for you to say, where am I in my committed walk with Christ? Are there some areas that honestly I could work on a little bit more? And so for this week and the next 6 weeks, we're really going to take a hard look at how can I serve him better? What is it I can do more to enrich my life and have that abundancy that he promises us? We're going to give you a couple of minutes now. If you don't have a card, that's okay too. You can write down on a piece of paper, Lord, I want to commit to you today. Lord, I'm not sure what I want to do today, but we're going to spend a couple of minutes in prayerful thought as you spend the time filling out the card or writing out, where am I in my commitment to Christ? So take a few minutes. Let's fill them out. You can fill it out sometime down the road, but feel free to, if you need a card, let us know. We'll make sure that you get a card. It's a beginning. We have to begin somewhere so we can take where we are and then move from there forward. If you've not accepted Christ in your life and you'd like to, let us know. We would love to talk with you about that and what that journey means. And if today you do want to give your life to Christ, then we are so excited about that commitment and would love to talk to you about that as well. We also know that as part of a commitment to Christ is to offer to Christ what we have. So if you'd like to donate some of your financial givings to the work of the church, to our playground, to other ministries of the church, we welcome that as well. You can use our Givelify application on app at the App Store if you don't have it downloaded on your phone. Let's pray. Oh God, as we leave here today, we leave knowing that you are a God of abundance, that you have everything that we need, everything, that if we follow you, trust you, keep our eyes on you, our life will make incredible change, make an incredible difference, and truly give us joy, peace, love, kindness. Be with us as we journey through these next weeks to find a way that we might truly commit to you in some new and important ways. We ask this in your name. Amen.
Givelify is giving simplified. Givelify is the simplest, most beautiful way to give and track donations to the place of worship or charity of your choice. You're not limited to the cash you have on hand. There's no need to write checks, and there are no complicated forms to fill out or text message codes to remember. Givelify automatically pinpoints your location and intelligently identifies the fundraiser, worship service, or conference you're attending without the need to search. Since Givelify automatically detects where you are, making a donation can be completed in as few as 3 taps. Tap 1, use one of the pre-configured denominations to choose your donation amount. Tap 2, select the campaign to which you'd like to contribute. Tap 3, with your stored credit or debit card, complete your donation in one tap and get an immediate donation receipt. Setting up recurring giving is a simple two-tap process. Tap the frequency you'd like, and you'll never forget to make your gift. Givelify lets you easily see your complete donation history. Mark the place of worship you normally attend as your home for quick one-tap access. Givelify. Tap. Give. Done.